George Ndirangu, presenter and producer at CNBC Africa. Before anything else, I could hear one or two whispers. We'll address the elephant in the room where there are three panelists, but the moderator is a man as well. So we'll, by the end of this session, we'll know why exactly we were picked. We needed to create some parity. Even as we continue to deliberate on the role that women have, we should also remember that men would also would like a role as you continue to progress as women. So we'll have that. So the MC has given a bit of their bios on what they have. So we know that the panelists that we have right in front here are passionate individuals. We'll hear about their passions just now. Giants within the industries with reputable backgrounds and a diverse set of opinions on gender parity from different parts of the world. So we'll start off with my immediate right, Lina Mukashaka. We'll go straight into it. Help us create context on your journey so far and one thing based off of your experiences that you're passionate about.
So my name's Lina Higiro. I'm very passionate. We're told to speak naturally. I'm very passionate about finding process gaps, very passionate about sales and making profitable connections with people. That's my introduction.
Very concise. We can tell that that's definitely a banker. Yeah.
Okay.
Very concise. Miss Fatou, or on your right, Fatou LO, acting rep for UN Women Rwanda. Same to you, same question posed to you.
Well, thank you very much. Good evening, everyone, and such a pleasure to be here and be part of this important conversation. My name is Fatou LO. I am originally from Senegal, and I've been in Rwanda for a year. I am passionate about advancing women's rights and the rights of girls as well. And that's what I've been doing since 1994, when I was still in high school. And and that's what I am still doing as head of UN Women. So it's been quite a journey, but such a privilege to actually have the opportunity to make the life of so many of our sisters, daughters, mothers better. It's really a privilege. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Dorian, over to you.
Yes, so I'm Dorian Daley. From California, so I've come a long ways, and I'm actually thrilled to be here. This is my first visit in Rwanda, and I will be back, and I'll probably be back within the year because there is much that we have to do here. And I know you're going to expect the lawyer to expound for a really long time. I'll be brief. I'm passionate about education. My mother was a teacher. My twin sister is a teacher. My oldest son is a teacher. And for me and my siblings as we were growing up, education was everything. Education not only meant opportunity, but it meant a breadth of experiences. It meant an opening of the mind. It meant a welcoming of other places and other cultures. And so I see it as a key to so many things, including the advancement of women in business and in government. So that's my passion.
All right, thank you for that. So we've heard from them, and I'm George Ndirangu. From a very young age, I was a passionate feminist. And when I was young, I did not understand what feminism was, but my dad wasn't there for a big part of my life. When I became a lot older now, I realized what it is, and I'm passionate about parity, everyone having a level playing field, regardless of gender, regardless of social class, and that is exactly the conversation we are set to have here today. And let's just kick off with Lina. Since you're on my immediate right, you get to face the heat first. Now, research has shown that companies with a greater share of women in their board, in their directors, executive committee, they tend to perform a lot better. Of course, this is just a personal question. I know we should be referring to a note, but I know it's more personal for you. You've handled strategy planning and marketing for one bank. You went and became a business manager, and you helped with SMEs across all tiers for another bank. Now you're COO of AB Bank. How true is this sentiment about women who tend to perform better financially than men?
I think it's very true. I joined a bank. I joined a bank, to my surprise, where 80% of the highest value depositors are women, which really surprised us, and the most frequent savers are women, and those with the lowest in NPL are women. So if we're talking about managing financial aspects of their lives, just from our bank that has about 14,000 active clients, that is testament that women do very well when they're given the opportunity to manage their own finances and their businesses.
All right. And do you feel, on your point before we go to Ms. Fatou, that this can be trickled down to different classes where we not only have to handle financial decisions, but decisions like that in the socio-economic perspective, socially? Can we trickle some of these financial decisions or decisions like that mm-hmm. into our social lives?
I think that all depends on the dynamics in your social life,
right?
You know, and how you're perceived in that social life. Sometimes you can be effective in business, but not effective socially. I think we've all seen it. You see a woman who's very good in her business, but when she goes home, she breaks down. Right. So I think it all depends on the strength a woman can carry and any support she can carry through to her social life. It's very difficult, I've seen it, and I think that's where it's going to take a long time to find a balance. There's a study which said it would take 84 years, I think it was Deloitte, 84 years for there to be a true balance, I mean, like economic and social, between men and women. So it's going to take time. As much as we have these numbers and women doing well in business, it's going to take time.
It's a work in progress.
It's a work in progress.
And let's move to Ms. Fatou. There's a legislation of law that states that the percentage of women that need to be in parliament and private sector are seeking to improve gender balance. Now, are we in senior positions because of the law or governance codes, or is it because the women who are put there actually are on merit? Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you very much. I think that is an extremely important question, and it goes back to this whole issue of quotas. And of course, the debate is that quotas undermine meritocracy, and it allows women, regardless of their qualifications, to get into the room. My own take, and I think it very much represents also the view of my organization, is that we need both. Women are not in the room just because of quotas. Some got there through their education, having displayed very strong qualifications and having met all the requirements. And in some cases, quotas were needed, and they will continue to be needed for a little while, because quotas should be understood as a mechanism to correct and reverse an imbalance that was created due to the lack of opportunities for so many women and girls. So in my view, women have earned their seats at the table, mm-hmm. and some women will need a little bit of push to get into that room and to get at that table. And for those, we will have to continue using quotas. In our jargon, we call them the temporary special measures. So they are by definition temporary, but they are special measures that are needed in the same way as affirmative actions have been needed in other contexts, in other countries where, for instance, the issue, the imbalance was race. So in this particular case of gender, it is indeed important to have those quotas. And I would strongly disagree that women are there just because of the quotas. Many of them have earned that seat, and it's high time we recognize that.
Dorian, we've heard from Lina and Fatou on the same. Let's get your view on awareness of this inclusiveness. Now, where are we on this front, both from a progress point on your end and barriers that need to be broken for everyone to understand the mandate that they have, regardless of gender?
So I think there is a very good awareness. The degree to which there is awareness depends on where you are in the world. So it depends somewhat, but I think, you know, generally there's good awareness that that we need to do more to bring women up in leadership positions. And certainly the example of Rwanda and what it's been able to do with women in business and in government, and I'll note that although the mandate may be 30%, as you said, there's 60% in government, so that shows it's not simply a quota issue, it's merit. That there's more that can be done to raise awareness, and that's why forums like this and lots of other organizations continue to talk about these issues. Do barriers still exist? Of course, barriers still exist. So even in places where we've made tremendous progress, there are going to be sectors where there are still issues. And they're the same barriers that many of us faced you know, 30 years ago. They're exactly the same. And so the notion that all is good, everything's okay, let's not worry about it now, I think we have to be very careful about that because we have to bring everybody along. I think one of the biggest barriers has to do with educational opportunity. That's still a huge barrier for women, particularly in certain areas in finance, in technology, in math, generally in STEM education, because there's this sense that girls just can't cut it. Mm-hmm. Girls can't make it in finance. You know, girls can't really handle engineering. And that's a myth that has been dispelled, but I think we have to keep talking about that narrative, using the examples, as we have here, of women who have achieved and at a very, very high level, celebrate them, and make sure there's a tremendous amount of awareness, and then do the things at the front end with the girls in school at a young age to bring them along with all kinds of educational opportunities, but even more so maybe in those historically those areas where historically they've really been denied access, and it's, well, as I say, it's changing in some areas. We still have a ways to go in other areas.
And let's talk about some another issue. I'll come back to you, Lina. The issue on, of course, as a top professional, you've noted that the higher you climb up the ladder, the less women, the less number of women. Now, what leads to women to not be as vocal about senior roles? I mean, there's a misconception that some are much more comfortable with the current level they are, or they would like to speak about getting a higher position, but are not so vocal about it. What has been your experience with the same?
I think there are many, many, many things that make women not reach those high levels. And in my experience, one is information. And I don't mean information that's published. I mean information that you get from your network. Not network only of women, but network of men, network of former colleagues. There's a lot, what they call the grapevine is so important. And I find sometimes women just, you know, you move sometimes from being, say, an officer to a manager, and you think, let me forget my former colleagues. But those are the people who have the information of what's changing in organizations. So I find sometimes we don't take the importance of grapevine. The second thing is not having male mentors, male advisors. You see, I've learned how to be a bit fearless because of the men who advise me and who are in the same sector. Because men have been around so long, they've had a step before us. Okay, we've also been around long. But they've been around, let's say, in the modern world, in boardrooms longer than us. So they've learned a lot before us. So I've found it's so many times, I'll give an example. I was stuck in one of my jobs, not stuck mentally, like I need to move, I need to make a change. So I approached this very senior person in the financial sector and I said, I'm stuck, I want to move, I want more leadership. You know the usual things we say? And this man said, you have to fight. And I looked at him and wondered, fight? Imagine he's telling me to fight. What kind of war do I have to go to fight? And I didn't understand it until about a few months later when an opportunity came, but I missed the date. Just, I'm making it very simple, we're told to make things simple. An opportunity came and I missed the date, and I remembered this man saying, fight. So I called on anyone who could make sure that I get that opportunity, even if the date was 3 weeks ago. And that person was one of my advisors, another person. I said, I need your name on my cover letter. He gave me his name. I got an interview within 24 hours, and I'm here today.
Now, let's move on to another set of numbers. It's very unfortunate that women on average, these are the numbers that we're working with, women work on average about 49 hours a week, per week. Men work 41 hours. Just that right there is very unfair. Yes, I know you're wondering how is this possible? So And the hours that men spend on economic work as opposed to domestic work, women do more domestic work in their 49 hours than men. So men have the luxury of working less and getting the most recognition, which is completely unfair if we're trying to create issues on gender parity. So I'll just throw it to Ms. Fatou. Help us understand this. How much of culture comes into play now? And what is you and women possibly doing to address such issues on culture?
Well, thank you. I think it is really, the figures you just shared are quite striking. And it's the reality all over the world that women spend much more time on what we call unpaid care work, which is all the work that involves taking care of the children, the sick person, the elderly. And of course, the nature of the unpaid care work varies, whether you are in the urban area or in the rural settings, with definitely a greater burden of unpaid care work on rural women. And indeed, as you rightly point out, it does take away a lot of time that women should be spending on income generating activities. And that contributes to a large extent to the gap that we see later on in terms of asset ownership, in terms of economic and financial independence between women and men. And I think, yes, culture plays a lot into that. Because there are expectations, right? When you are a woman, you are indeed expected to cook, to clean, to care for the elderly, the sick, if you are in the rural setting, the animals as well. So there are just expectations, and these are stereotypes. That whole process of making us become a woman and cleaning and cooking, and those are activities that some men enjoy. Today, I look at one of my brothers who's living abroad, and it's beautiful to see him. He can, his wife can travel for a whole month and he'll be fine. And he will take care of the kids and he will cook and clean and he enjoys it. So I think, you know, this whole concept of also masculinity and what we expect of men, men shouldn't cry. So when we talk about stereotypes, it's not only women who are affected, but also for men, there is a lot of pressure in terms of what a man should look like. What defines you as a man? You should be providing. If you cannot provide, then it speaks about your value. It touches your value as a human being. And I think those are some of the mindset, the stereotypes, and the attitudes we need to shift and in order to change the society. And that's why culture plays in a great deal into women's ability to rise to the top. And unless we are able to challenge those, and I can tell you they are very stubborn. They are huge, huge barriers. And you ask me what UN Women is doing about it. And that's why we launched a couple of campaigns in recent years, one of them very famous here in Rwanda. Let me just speak very briefly about the Women Empowerment Principles that we launched a few years back. I think it was back in 2007, which was about targeting the private sector and saying, as the greatest employer in most countries, what are you going to do to make sure that the workplace is friendly to women? What are you going to do in terms of policies, in terms of even the facilities? Are you going to have breastfeeding rooms? Are you going to have a children's room in case some women cannot come to work because the nanny didn't show up? So those kinds of transformation and changes, and many enterprises, many companies globally adopted those women empowerment principles. And they will tell you, listen, there are seven principles. I cannot take them all, but let me take one or two and start introducing the changes that we need to see in the corporate world. Now, the second campaign, which is probably much more famous and most of you know about, is the He for She campaign. And you know that here in Rwanda, we are very, very blessed because the president himself, His Excellency President Kagame, is one of the champion, the 10 heads of state who are championing that campaign. Now, Rwanda is also leading on that front with close to 160,000 signatures, meaning that many men are supporting the cause of women and girls and are embracing gender equality as a principle to live by. However, signatures are only signatures. And I think that's why the president, in addition to signing, made three commitments. One is about TVET, closing the gender gap and bringing more girls into TVET, giving them the skills that they need to be employable. The second is about ICT. We know that Rwanda is doing quite well when it comes to ICT. So how do we leverage digital technology to make sure that girls are also, along with the education, the STEM education, they go along, are able to jump into the 21st century, because it's not about, we no longer have time to go through all the steps. We have to literally take the elevator and move very fast. And I think what the president has committed to doing on ICT is really one of those pathway to greater progress and faster progress. And finally, he took a commitment to eliminate sexual and gender-based violence. And this is very critical, because that's also one of those very stubborn issues that are not going away, and yet they are very symptomatic of an imbalance in terms of rights. When a man can allow himself to beat his wife or girlfriend or sister for many different reasons, it's simply just not acceptable.
Thanks a lot for that breakdown. Now, we'll have one more round of questions after I ask Dorian her question. And after that, we'll throw the ball now to the audience. You're encouraged to ask as many questions as you can. We have about half an hour to get all your questions. So as I ask the last round, please just prepare some questions. Ms. Fatou talked about masculinity. And one of the things that ties in into that is how aggressive most men are in the workplace and in life in general. And the another unfair thing about it is the more aggressive a man is, the more likable he is. But for women, it's different. The more aggressive you are, it compromises on your likability. So how do we work out now a system where we can see a lot more aggressiveness and a lot more likability going hand in hand, binary?
Sure. So I think you can be aggressive and not be abrasive. Women are particularly good at this. And, you know, not so much. But I think women are sort of constitutionally inclined toward being able to work through the issues, but be very, very persistent. So I don't think, you know, some of this is a mindset, the notion that a woman who is being aggressive about a particular issue is being abrasive. But I think this, you know, we can take this up. And we have seen so many women be able to deal with this sort of by their natures, but also because they've been able to get some assistance, they've been able to get some training, they've been able to get some coaching. But that's on the women's side. Much of it has to do with, you know, dealing with the mindset of the men in the organizations, and particularly those that are quite entrenched and who maybe don't have a background or a home life that is as progressive or as enlightened as some of the women who are coming up. So what can we do about this? Aside from the training, the skills development, to how you build business, to how you pursue the goal, how you fight for what it is that you really want, I think much of it does involve dealing with the men. Let's not exclude the men in this journey. They are part of the journey. They are part of the path. One of my most important mentors, aside from my dear father, was a man who gave me my job at Oracle from the very outset. He remains a very close friend and a very close mentor. Those things can't be forgotten. But the way that we interact with our male colleagues is also very important. Not forgetting them, not dismissing them, not excluding them, but drawing them in. One of the things that we're trying to do now is to bring more and more men into our events and our organization, so they're part of the dialogue. And I think importantly too, what do we do with our brothers? What do we do with our sons? Most importantly, what do we do with our sons? There's a lot of focus on what we do for our daughters to give them that confidence to step up and to reach out and maybe break some stereotypes in the various places where you know, we live and work.
Thank you very much for that. So that concludes the first half hour. Now we're getting into our second bit. I will ask just one or two questions and then we'll throw it over to you. I'm sure we'll have a microphone that we should be able to pass around the room, and then we'll get, of course, all of you asking as many questions as possible. Let's continue with our set of questions. Lina, I'll have to come back to you. Now, we had Dorian talking about the role that women have and aggressiveness and likability, I'll just would like to hear it from your point. There's also another notion. Women tend to hold each other back. Or when you see another woman in society getting a promotion or getting a bit ahead, they tend to not applaud as much as, I can see a few nods in the room, so I know I'm not off track. They don't applaud as much. So in your experiences, trying to elevate each other, both professionally and socially, knowing very well that you are not as at the same level, or maybe you have the same opportunities, but you didn't make the most of them on yourself or on your end. Just help us understand what some of your experiences have been.
I think if you're competitive and you see another woman doing very well, something inside of you will be like, why didn't I get that? It's natural. If you're not competitive, you're not going to have that. So I think what women forget is that to also get there is to talk to that woman, make that woman your friend. And I've started having what I call, some people who know me, learning lunches with women who I really don't have a connection to, but I appreciate certain things about them. And in that, I have actually, you know, you understand somebody's path, and that thing you have in you that's saying, how come she got there, it just dies off. Because somehow in those, what I call learning lunches, which is, I just make an appointment with Christine. We've only met in an institution, like an event like this. But when we sit down and talk, I say, I just want to learn from you. How do you do it? Such meetings just will help us move ahead together.
Let's just get your view, Ms. Fatou, on the same question. What is your view on the same, progressing and trying to hold each other back?
Well, I have to say, I mean, it's a reality. It's a reality, and it goes back to that whole issue of mindset. Because in the same way that some men cannot really accept the idea of a woman being ahead of them, or just in general doing well in their careers, we have women who share those views too and would think, okay, what business do you have trying to run for office instead of taking care of your family? Or, you know, why aren't you devoting more time to your children or to your husband, and so on. So I do believe that it's a reality that women tend to hold each other back at times, but it's because of the perception that they have and their expectation of what a woman should look like and what a woman should be doing. Of course, I mean, there is the whole issue of being competitive and just human nature coming into play in terms of, you know, maybe thinking, okay, she's doing well and why not me, then let me bring her down. But I think it's a huge reality, and we cannot deny it, because we've seen it, especially this past year, play out big times in politics, in several different areas where we couldn't expect that, you know. So for those of us, maybe women who want to celebrate other women doing well and who want to see the women ahead, because it means something. As women today, we're standing on the shoulders of so many other women who came before us. The struggle of our grandmothers are not the same as our struggles. The struggle of our mothers are also different, and so will be the struggle of our girls, will also be different. But we each have to play our role at that particular time and do what is right and what is needed. And that involves us women supporting each other and not bringing each other down. We do see instances of that. It's just way too common. And I think the shift in mindset, what Dorian was referring earlier to, has to happen, yes, among men and boys, but also among women. And if you allow me, I just want to touch on a story, the whole story of female genital mutilation, for instance. Who practices that, who perpetuates that? It's women. And so that is different from bringing women down in their careers, but I'm just giving that example to also say that, you know, the shift in mindset is needed among women as well. And we have to start accepting and projecting women as president, and to see more of that. It has to be the new normal. It has to be the new normal, and it has to be accepted and internalized, my take on it.
Speaking of internalization, we spoke to a few ladies when the STEM projects were picking up here in Rwanda, and most of them expressed the same sentiments. I'll find a man or a boy in class who knows math better than me, or who understands technical aspects more than me. But just from your perspective, Dorian, just help us understand some challenges that have come about trying to urge young ladies to get into STEM, and maybe what you've done to address them.
Sure. I mean, I think there are these old sort of legacy or historical constructs that many of us grew up with that, you know, boys are just better at math, science, and technology, and it's just not true. As you say, the brains are the same. It's the encouragement that you get at an early age. And so there are a lot of organizations, including ours, that focus on education in those areas at a very, very early age, all through university. Because if you open up the opportunity, if you make it interesting and exciting, if you show absolutely no difference between what you're providing to the boys and to the girls, and frankly, some focused opportunities for girls who may have already sort of learned those behaviors that, you know, I can't be good at math or science, so you provide some forum where the girls just can go and they can have a code fest or a hackathon, something like that, builds up their confidence. Those are incredibly important. And so you have to start at the early age and you have to carry it all the way through. You have to make it very accessible and fun at the outset and all the way through. And when you start to see some of those girls who are starting to waver a little bit, give them a little bit more encouragement. So there are lots of programs. We run programs through the Oracle Academy, which is designed really to educate students at all levels in computer science. And we do it through a variety of programs. Some we run on our own, some we have partners, some are other programs that we can fund, and they really run the gamut from these things like, you know, a code fest or a hackathon. Here in Rwanda, just recently partnered with K-Labs to have an event to encourage children in ICT. And I think we trained about 30 children through this very, very innovative program called Alice, which Alice, and there's another program called Greenleaf, I think is what it's called, where they're software programs designed to teach very young children programming. So they learn programming skills through this very fun, interactive computer program. And then they can start taking it to the next level and to the next level. So we just did this with K-Labs. We have workshops. We have something called Workshop in a Box that uses some of these programs. We have Girls in ICT. We, through the Oracle Women's Leadership Organization and Oracle Volunteers, will take women in our organizations, different kinds of organizations, frankly, and bring them to various schools to just simply act as mentors and as examples of women who persevered and made it and were terribly successful. That's just a handful of the kinds of programs that you can, we and others can do to encourage that kind of learning, starting at a very, very early age and then carrying it all the way through.
Well, thank you very much for that, and thanks to the panelists for that. Now, that marks the end of my round of questioning for the panelists. Now it's time to throw it to the floor.
I can see a very successful woman, and I'm sure that some of us might be looking up to you. So I had, it's a set of three questions, but you don't have to elaborate much. But so they always say that there is a price to pay for most of the success that we achieve. So I wanted to know what are the price, or what is one of the price that you feel like you paid to get where you are? And the second is there anything that you look back and think you would have done differently if you were to go back? And in a nutshell, one of your main do and one of your main don't as a woman if you want to get to your success. So those are my questions.
Well, I'll answer the first one, because that one's easy. And I don't agree with it. Fundamentally, I don't agree that there's a huge sacrifice that you have to make. And I think that thinking is what holds some women back. You know, I can't be both a successful businesswoman or a successful lawyer or a successful politician, and I can't have a successful home life. It's just not possible. And you know, I'm here to tell you it is possible. It's not always easy. And for those women that are looking for this absolute homework balance, you know, we can tell you there's not absolute equilibrium all of the time. In fact, there's never absolute equilibrium in anything in our lives all of the time. The challenge is, you know, how you manage that, how you are able to focus on the thing that is in front of you right now, as you're also kind of thinking out ahead about how you have to deal with other things. But I think thinking that there has to be some huge sacrifice is fundamentally wrong. There's a challenge. And the big question is, are you up for the challenge or aren't you? Try to.
I don't know whether you'd like to take the question on anything you'd have done differently if you were to look back.
Yes, sure. Looking back, I think the only thing I would have done differently is to reach even higher. I do think at times, you know, oh, I should have, you know, been an astronaut or something like that. So I'm really, really excited when I see my nieces today having these huge dreams, and they totally want to go to Mars, and I'm all for it. That's the only thing I would have done differently. An astronaut or a pilot or something linked to STEM. I do have to say that maybe at some point in my life I dreaded the mathematics a little too much, and for various reasons. Maybe it was just not my forte, but in hindsight, I do think that, you know, at a young age we have so many possibilities, and the sky is truly the limit. Or as I've read recently, the mind is now the limit, right? It's no longer even the sky, it's the mind that can be the limit. So the only thing I would have done differently, and I'm being very, very sincere about it, is to reach even higher.
Now, Lina, of course, math to you is your daily bread, eating in and out. So for you, math is not a problem. The question on the main do's and don'ts.
The main don't is, there's so many don'ts. The main don't is just, okay, let's talk external and yourself. The main don't is not to underestimate anyone. And I mean the person who cleans your toilets at the office, to the person who's your security guard, to whoever it is next to you. Those are the people who give you a lot of insight. And that's what I think. Many times I've seen many women, and sometimes men, by the time they even just become a supervisor, they don't talk, let's talk bank, they don't talk to their teller, you know, it destroys your path already, because that teller can influence your next step. And then the main do is continuing to be relevant. Being relevant is tough, it's a hard job. Somebody once told me that I left her in the boardroom, and she used to wonder why I always used to say something, come with prepared. Now she says, oh my goodness, it's so hard to stay relevant, you can disappear. So you have to be relevant, and being relevant means reading broadly. It means keeping up with your, watching the dynamics in your boardroom, and working with those dynamics to always make sure you get buy-in. And so those for me are the do's and the don'ts. Yeah, don't forget those behind you and keep relevant.
All right. We have 1, 2, 3 questions.
So my question is back to the money, right? Because I think, you know, as women, we are making advancements and we are getting into leadership positions, not in as the numbers that we would like to see, but I think there's still an inequality in how much women get paid for the same type of work that men get paid. And sometimes we find that we're even more qualified than the men, but for the same types of jobs, we will be paid less. And there's legislation that, you know, tries to address this issue, but it continues to persist even in the developed world. So my question is, in your experience, are we making inroads on that, you know, to sort of reverse that? And also, is it something that we as women need to address individually, or is it at an organizational level? Really, where is the solution to getting equal pay for equal work with men?
For public sector, generally, equal pay for equal work is not an issue, right? We take the example of Rwanda, where there is a law that is quite clear about it. But I believe that in the private sector, the other issue we face as women in particular is the negotiation of salary level, of grade, of asking for more. You will find that most men, even when they're not qualified for it, they will go for that higher position. Men, there is data that shows, evidence showing, that when men look at a job description, if they meet 65% of the requirements, they go for it. Because they know that they can learn on the job. And they allow themselves to actually learn on the job. For us women, we tend to be more perfectionist. For good reasons sometimes, and then for bad reasons. Because if we fail, we are criticized. Going back to the issue of failure or the issue of leading men, you are under scrutiny and nothing will be forgiven. And therefore, what do we do when we see a job description? Unless we meet 99% of the requirements, we're not going to apply. Those are some of the shifts. And this issue of equal pay, I mean, at the end of the day, quite often what do you see is that the woman will always, because she hasn't negotiated from the beginning, it is sometimes hard to make that shift and to ask for more. Because you would think, okay, if I demand more, I want a better salary. At the interview, you will not negotiate. I know very few women who will actually say, well, what can we do about it? And so one tip that I've personally used was to say, can I take this and we renegotiate in 3 months? I don't really like it, but can I take it and we renegotiate in 3 months? And believe me, 3 months later, once you're there, you go for it and you demand whatever you want and it will be paid to you. And I've had colleagues who were like, how did she do this? You know, but so it goes back to this whole issue of negotiation, your ability to negotiate, to be assertive, to really know what you are worth, what you are bringing, and to be able to have that conversation. It's a difficult conversation. I'm not underestimating. It's a difficult one, but it is a conversation that is worth having because it impacts you on the long run in terms of your ability to get to those higher positions, the ability to be treated fairly and equally on the job.
So I think you've heard on one perspective, it's a negotiation, it's individual. I'm going to be somewhat contrarian. I think it's both. And if you're leading a large organization or a large institution, you've got to have visibility from an organizational standpoint on what the different levels are and what's happening in the different levels. Not just the leveling that somebody's brought at, but what experience they brought to it. And I think you need to have an organizational structure that will help you with that data and that information. It's just too difficult otherwise. And have some guidelines from your organization that, you know, at least encourage, if not enforce, a band that you've got to stay within for people within a particular level. So I think it's both from my point of view. Oof.
Thank you. I'm Josephine and I work for the Ministry of Youth and ICT here in Rwanda. And firstly, I really thank you for the great inspirations as you share your stories and insights. I believe that once you fail, the true fail is when you stop trying whatever you're doing. And I want to hear from you what could have been maybe or had been your greatest failure and how did you come over it and take courage to carry on, because I believe most of the women are stuck somewhere because they just failed and someone told them maybe I told you shouldn't have tried something like that. As the reality is in Africa, as technology advances, women tend to stay behind even further than just in education. So the gender digital divide is widening. So what Oracle is doing to address that and put a response to that gender digital divide. Thank you.
There is a lot that we can do as technology companies and government ministries to be able to put technology in the hands of children at a young age, to give them computer science training and education, to make it not scary, to make it not fearful, to make it fun and exciting, and to make sure that we're bringing along the boys and the girls at the same time. And as I said before, in certain instances, maybe focus just on the girls to the extent that you've got girls who are somewhat intimidated by having the boys in the room. We're doing it. I think other companies are doing it. The ministries that we speak to here in Rwanda and across the continent are very, very interested in hearing about how we can engage with them, how we can engage with other partners to do this. So I think there's been a lot of change in this area, both engaging with the students and, really importantly, engaging with the teachers. Because you can put technology in the hands of teachers, and if you don't train them how to use it or how to teach it, it's a huge waste of money. So a lot of the emphasis and the focus is there as well. I just wanted to answer the one question that was asked, or try to answer, or weekly answer, maybe say, the answer the question about how do we do it? And the answer really is, there's no single path. There's no magic formula. We've probably, if you take a look at 10 women who have achieved, a high degree of success in their careers or the top position within their management chains, there are going to be some similarities. There will be some differences, though, in terms of background and experience and who was there and who encouraged and family situation. But I think where the commonality is that drive, that desire to learn and continue learning, that persistence, that being able to push out the noise and be very, very focused on what the prize is, and to be able to bring others along at the same time so that you're not only creating your own network of support, which is so important to all of us, but you're also creating an environment for those who come after you, whether they're women that are 10 years younger or 20 years or 40 years younger, that you're bringing them up in the same kinds of ways. So I think we do a disservice to our gender to try to think that there's a single path, there is a magic formula. Talk to people, think about your own experience, figure out what works for you and where you want to be, and you have to forge that path. It's not easy for those of us that are here, for those of you that are in the room who are, I've read the list, you're all, leaders in your organizations. It's not easy, but big question is whether or not you want to take that challenge. You enjoy learning, you want to work hard, and you want to be able to bring others along with you. Well.
Thank you very much for that. Now, we've come to the end of the round of questioning, but there was one question that was asked about the greatest failures. You were meant to give your closing remarks. I think we should just have it as an answer to that question. We'll just take 1 minute each, just about a minute each. Everything seems to be working so well, but we need to understand what your greatest failure has been leading up to now and how you overcame it.
Sure. So I think it's important to remember that failure is a process of learning. And if you think about one of the big trends right now in tech, it's this concept of iterative design. And big foundational piece of that is embracing failure as a mechanism for learning and trying the next thing. For me, I'll share a story because there are a few, but I'll share a story early on in my career as a young lawyer when I was in private practice. And I had a complaint that had been filed against a client, and I needed to file a response of pleading. And by law, you're required to file your response of pleading within a certain period of time. And if you don't do it within that period of time, you can have a default judgment taken against the client. I missed the filing deadline. I was a first-year associate, and I missed the filing deadline. What I did was I went to my partner. I told him what had happened. I took full responsibility for it, for the calendaring errors, for everything. Took full responsibility for it. Didn't try to put it off on anyone else, a legal assistant, a legal secretary. I owned it. It was my issue. When he said, well, I'm going to have to go into court and try to get the default judgment reversed, I said, no, let me do that. I own it. This is mine. I went to the judge. I explained what happened. And I persuaded him to reverse the default judgment, and I was able to move on. It became known within the within the firm, not the mistake that I had made, but how I'd owned the mistake and I had fixed it. I had properly fixed it, and then of course didn't make it again. But that was the key, is we're all gonna fail at some point. And we're probably gonna fail at different points in our careers along the line. You don't reach 10 years of experience and all of a sudden you don't have any more failures. We make mistakes, we make errors. It's how you deal with that and how you move on and how you fix it that I think is the real measure of how successful you can be.
It's a very important and interesting question, and this whole trend towards just acknowledging that those, I mean, failures do happen, and then when they happen, what do we do about it and how do we grow stronger out of it is extremely commendable. In my own case, I think I encountered failure very early on in my education. I had failed an exam, which was very, very strange because I was a fairly good student, but for some reason, maybe on that particular day, maybe whatever questions were asked, I just wasn't well prepared for that particular set of questions, and I failed the exam. And I was very, very young. We have these very tough exams that we take back home when we are just about 11 or 12. So, and they determine whether you go to secondary school and which school you go to. And when I failed that exam, I went and told my parents, and my mom said, oh, no problem, you're just going to go and continue into private school. Now, private school in our country at that time was terrible. It's like you go there when you fail, actually, so everybody knows that you didn't pass the exam. And then my dad said, well, listen, he was the at the head of education in the country, like equivalent to the Minister of Education, Secretary General of Education, and he said, you know, you just do the exam again. You're young and, you know, this is public education and I am every day telling everybody to, you know, go to public schools and I can't picture my daughter going to private school. So you'll make up for it, it's fine. You just, you know, do it all over again. Now doing it all over again required spending a whole year studying the same subjects and all of that. And because it happened at such a young age, I remember going at the back of the house and saying, well, I will just not let this happen ever again. And it turned me into a sort of a perfectionist. But that was my very early sort of encounter with failure. Now, in terms of the professional experience, of course, we have you know, many, many examples. But for me, at least, that was a turning point in the sense that in many ways, I think it defined who I became afterwards. And I can tell you from that day, from that time on, all the way and throughout my studies, I would be like first in everything, except in mathematics, but I would be second or third in math. So it is, I think it is important. And again, it's all about the issue of how you then, you know, pick up the pieces, whatever the pieces are. Of course, for me, it was like the end of the world at the time. And now in hindsight, I'm like, it was absolutely nothing. And I almost feel sorry that I felt that way and had to make that commitment that this is how I'm going to lead my life, not to allow any of those things to happen. But I think someone talked about being genuine and being really candid about some of these issues that we faced and how they have affected us in the long run. And for me, that was one of the most determining, most important moment in building the person I am today.
A failure, you know, I was a struggler in school. I was never these kids who were given a top three. So I was always a struggler. And I think because I was always a struggler, through struggling and not being the best, but trying and passing, you tend to develop an attitude of empathy. You know, you don't beat down anybody who fails. But let me go to the professional life. There's once where I call a failure. There's once the theme in my career is keep walking. So if I see opportunities, I will start looking. Keep walking. You know. Even in your job, keep walking, take a project, even if it's not related to you, but just keep walking. So once I said, oh, this opportunity has come up. I was interviewed, they loved me, and then they put me through this test, which I failed miserably. And I was so embarrassed, and I thought everyone has seen these results, and it was actually very embarrassing because it was within the industry. So I thought, that's it. I will never be hired by anyone after this. After that, I just stopped looking. I froze. I just stayed where I was. I was so scared of having to do any other move that would require me to go through a test. And I think I missed some opportunities. I think I should have been a COO a long time ago. So sometimes I think that's the greatest failure, where you fail and you really feel it, and you think the whole world is looking. And for me, that was the greatest failure.
We need to really marinate in everything that has been said. We intended that this conversation would happen for 1 hour. But I'm sure most of you who saw the agenda as well know that it was set to be for 1 hour. But just please, a warm round of applause, because they handled what I threw at them, what you threw at them, and what life has thrown at them over the years to still stay as graceful and classy as they are right now. So please, a very warm round of applause. Thank you for everything. I've been your moderator, George Ndirangu. Thank you for creating time.